For the 2022 model year, we are finally getting a crop of actually small pickup trucks in the United States. The first one is going to be this new 2022 Hyundai Santa Cruz, and then coming soon, we're also going to be getting the new 2022 Ford Maverick. But this is actually going to be the smallest truck in America. Not quite as small as you might remember from the 1970s or 1980s, but still definitely smaller than the average half ton. The new Santa Cruz and the Ford Maverick are very much like the Honda Ridgeline in that they are based on front-wheel drive crossovers. But there's also a bit of a difference. The Ridgeline is based on a Pilot, a mid-size three-row crossover, and the Santa Cruz is theoretically based on the Hyundai Tucson, and certainly styled more like the Tucson. That's very similar to what we see in the Ford Maverick. But you should know that this is quite a bit larger than the Tucson, because they wanted to give us the same kind of interior space for five passengers as you'd find in a Tucson, with a usable bed in the back. The big reason you might want to get this over the Honda Ridgeline is price tag. This is at least $13,000 less expensive, starting at $23,990. To create the Santa Cruz, what Hyundai did was they took the Tucson and then they threw pretty much the entire exterior away. So even though this front end design looks like the Tucson, it is in fact not the same front end. We have very similar LED daytime running lights. These are standard, but halogen headlights are found on most of the versions of the Santa Cruz. You'll only get the LED lights that you see in this model in the top end trim and the SEL premium trim, which will set you back at least $35,680. One interesting twist is that these turn signals in here, I think, are actually pointing the wrong way. The one over here is pointing in that direction. The one on the other side is a chevron pointing this way. You might be wondering, why is the front end different than the Tucson? The big reason is that not only is this longer than the Tucson, it's definitely wider as well. It's 75 inches wide. That makes this wider than the mid-size two-row Santa Fe. The next thing Hyundai did to create this from the Tucson is stretch it by an enormous amount. This is 13 inches longer than a Hyundai Tucson, significantly longer than those 1970s Toyota pickup trucks that you might be thinking of. And that's because they wanted to give this the interior volume of a compact crossover like the Tucson, plus the practicality of the bed. This is exactly the same thing that we see in the Maverick. But the Maverick is actually longer than this. It's a significant 4 inches longer. A lot of folks mistakenly thought that the Maverick was teeny tiny because it looks like a Bronco Sport, but it in fact is about the same size on the outside as a Ford Explorer. So this is going to be a little bit easier to park. But this is still 7 inches longer than the Hyundai Santa Fe. The reality is that in order to give you a practical cargo bed in the rear and the interior volume of a compact crossover, this has to be just about as long as Hyundai's three-row Palisade. This is just 1 inch shorter than that three-row Hyundai, and just about as wide as well. With light modules that wrap from the body onto the tailgate, the designers of the Santa Cruz were a little bit more adventurous than some of the pickup truck competition. Speaking of the tailgate, it's a nicely damped unit that helps you open and close the tailgate, so you don't need a lot of upper body strength to do that. They have a huge Santa Cruz logo right there at the bottom of the tailgate, typical pickup truck styling for the bumper with well-integrated steps. Now let's talk about cargo carrying. One of the more unique features of the Santa Cruz is that we have a factory installed roller cover on the cargo bed. It actually has a bit of a load rating as well. It's probably not exactly high enough to support me, but it's actually pretty close and it feels very sturdy. It also is centrally lockable, so it locks with the vehicle, and because this is the only one factory installed, it integrates really, really well with the vehicle. Now, on the downside, if you get this particular option, you do have to give up a little bit of cargo capacity. The roller cargo goes into this little area here. There's a metal compartment, and it's about 6 inches by 6 inches. So that is going to take up some of the cargo area right there at the front of the bed. The bed itself is 52.1 inches long. It's 53.9 inches wide, so a little bit wider than what we see in the Ford Maverick, but about 2 inches shorter in this dimension. It is a whopping 13 inches shorter than the Honda Ridgeline because this is in a different category. This is trying to be a compact pickup truck. The Ridgeline is a mid-sized pickup truck, trying to compete with things like the Ford Ranger or the Toyota Tacoma, and that's why this is so much less expensive. Now, you should know that while you could put a 4x8 sheet of something theoretically in here and then hanging out the opening there by about 18 inches or 20 inches or so, it's not going to fit between the wheel wells. Between the wheel wells, it's just 42.7 inches. As you'd expect in a cargo practical vehicle, there are a number of different tie downs, some slots where you could put 2x6s to give you a two-tiered storage area. You can either grab the top and roll it around, or we have a little bit of a leash here that helps you grab it right from the back. There's also a trick that we saw in the Honda Ridgeline in here, which is an underbed trunk. But unlike the Ridgeline, this is a little bit smaller. The main reason for that is that the bed is closer to the ground, so they had a little bit less room, and the spare tire is located under the truck rather than inside the cargo bed. That's an awful lot more practical than where we see it in the Ridgeline. In the Ridgeline, if you got a flat tire and this area was full and the bed was full, you'd have to take everything out to get to the spare tire. In here, you don't have to. When it comes to payload figures, there has been a little bit of confusion surrounding the Santa Cruz, so let's try and clear some of that up. According to Hyundai, payload should vary between 1,906 pounds at the upper end and 1,568 pounds for the top end limited trim. But keep in mind that that payload figure can get further reduced by the options you select, like the roller cargo cover or the factory towing package. So the model that I'm driving today has a door sticker payload rating of 1,411 pounds. There's also been a little bit of confusion about how much of that weight can go in the cargo bed. There was some initial reporting that it was limited to just about 600 or 650 pounds. According to Hyundai, that is incorrect, but they haven't given a specific specification for that cargo area payload just yet. Hyundai just sent me a very detailed explanation of the Santa Cruz's payload capacity, so let's just pause the video and take a deep dive into that right now. Apparently, 1,906 pounds is the highest the payload will go, and that is in the 2.5-liter model, naturally aspirated in front-wheel drive. The 2.5T all-wheel drive tops out theoretically at 1,568 pounds, assuming you don't add any additional options to the vehicle. Now, here's where things get a little bit tricky. Initially, they had said 660 pounds in the bed. And because I think the engineers at Hyundai love giving way more detail than most people would ever get here, they have explained what the 660 pounds is. That is 660 pounds in the bed with one driver that weighs 200 pounds and four passengers in the cabin. So 660 pounds is what you've got left because payload includes the driver and the passengers. They've also said you can do 660 pounds in the bed while towing a 5,000 pound trailer with 500 pounds of tongue weight, one driver and one passenger in the cabin. That's actually pretty decent, to be honest. And the bed capacity can be around 1,000 pounds with only a driver and a passenger in the vehicle. Theoretically, you could put 1,446 pounds just in the bed, but you wouldn't be able to move the truck because, of course, you have to have a driver to drive the vehicle and theoretically maybe a passenger or so up front. So some of the initial claims that 660 pounds was all you could ever put in the bed are incorrect, and I think that just has to do with the way that Hyundai decided to explain the payload capacity. As always, remember that payload is inclusive of the driver and any passengers and any cargo on the inside. So you put a 200-pound person in front, theoretically back here, 1,200 pounds is what you could put in this particular truck. Enabling that is a standard low-leveling rear suspension, which is a unique feature in the truck segment and one that I really like because it helps keep the suspension dynamics pretty level in the rear, so the car is going to behave more appropriately when you have a few hundred pounds in the back. Trailer sway control is also standard, and towing will range between 3,500 pounds and 5,000 pounds when properly equipped. You'll get 5,000 pounds in the all-wheel drive model. At least for the moment, two engines are offered in the Santa Cruz. They have been a little bit cagey as to whether or not a hybrid system might come in the future, but because there is a hybrid in the Santa Fe and the Tucson, logically it would fit under this hood if they decided to do that. The base engine has been borrowed out of the Hyundai Santa Fe. It's a 2.5-liter four-cylinder engine producing 191 horsepower and 181 pound-feet of torque. That's mated to a standard 8-speed automatic transmission, your choice of front-wheel drive or all-wheel drive, and regardless of what you choose, that engine is going to get you 23 miles per gallon combined. If you want more oomph or more towing ability, we have this engine here. It's basically the same 2.5-liter turbo also found under the hood of the Hyundai Santa Fe. It produces 281 horsepower, a whopping 311 pound-feet of torque, and it's mated to an 8-speed dual-clutch transmission instead of a traditional automatic. All-wheel drive is standard with the turbo, and this gets just 1 mile per gallon less than the all-wheel drive naturally aspirated option, which is really not a bad trade-off for a whole lot more power. Now, on the downside, both of these engines are going to be less efficient than the engine lineup in the Ford Maverick, but this one is going to give you way more oomph. 0 to 60 in this model comes in at about 6.3 seconds. When it comes to active driver assist technologies, there's a little bit less standard on the Santa Cruz than in some of Hyundai's other models. Forward collision warning with autonomous braking and pedestrian detection is standard, as is lane keeping assistance and lane departure warning, but you have to move up to the SEL trim if you want blind spot warning and rear cross traffic detection, and all the way up to limited all-wheel drive if you want adaptive cruise control, the 360 degree camera system, and Hyundai's more aggressive lane centering system that they're calling the Highway Driving Assist system. The front seats in the Santa Cruz have essentially been lifted out of the Hyundai Tucson, and that's certainly a good thing for this vehicle, because for some reason, if we take a look at Ford's midsize truck or the Chevy midsize truck or the Toyota Tacoma, the front seats are not as comfortable as midsize crossovers from those same brands, because the front seat is not exactly the same. And here, it's basically the same. We get a two-way adjustable lumbar support, multi-way power driver seat, manual tilt telescopic steering column with a pretty decent range of motion as well. Now, it's worth noting that even in this top-end trim, the front passenger seat is not powered. It is a manual design. Jumping into the back seat, there's definitely a generous amount of room here, about the same kind of legroom that we find in the Honda Ridgeline. I have about 3 inches of legroom with this front seat comfortably adjusted for me at 6 feet tall. It's probably a little bit further back than I normally sit. Moving to the middle, however, you will notice that this is based on a compact vehicle. And the one big difference between this and the Ridgeline is the width of the truck generally. And you will notice that the rear bench is about 2 inches narrower than that Ridgeline. However, there's still plenty of room. This front seat is all the way back in its track, suitable for a taller person up front. I still have about an inch of legroom left and tons of headroom. You probably see in this video how much headroom I have. It's about 3 inches or so. This model has the moonroof option, which does cut down on this area of the roof, but they then have a dish back up so that we have more headroom back here. One odd thing you should know about this interior is that we don't have a fold-down center armrest or any cup holders right there in the center console. That means that the only cup holders we get are the ones integrated into the doors. But you'll notice that little icon right there that says you shouldn't put takeout-style drinks in here because, of course, if you had one in there and then you closed the door, that drink would be all over the interior. As we look around the interior together, keep in mind that I am in essentially the very top-end version of the Santa Cruz. So we have a pretty standard-sized moonroof there, just over the driver and front passenger's heads. And from this angle, you can really see how much that rear ceiling style dips in there. We also have that manual rear window, height-adjustable shoulder belts for the driver and front passenger, and two-way adjustable headrests. The leather upholstery in this model is perforated because the front seats are heated and ventilated. This also has a heated steering wheel. You see there's a little bit of contrasting piping going on there and a reasonable amount of soft touch material. This interior styling has definitely been lifted out of the Hyundai Tucson, but there are a few tweaks because the interior is just a little bit wider here and there. Although exactly where there are changes, I'm not sure. The styling of the dashboard is very much the same, but Hyundai has not said whether any of these parts are actually exactly the same. On the front doors, there's a strip of piano black trim, and then just below that, there's a fabric insert. Hyundai has been adding fabric inserts to some of their vehicle interiors lately, and it really helps dress things up. It's a relatively inexpensive way of making things feel a bit more premium. That fabric strip runs all the way over to the dashboard. You can see it joins up right there. And then between that air vent on the far right side of your screen over there and the one over here on the left, there's actually an air vent right out there. So even though this kind of is styled like other new vehicles where nothing is going on there in the middle, in here there actually is something going on, and it's controlled via this diffuse button right here in the climate control system. If I press that button, then air starts coming out of the little holes right there in that area. Just below that, there's a moderately sized glove compartment. I was barely able to fit a 10-inch tablet computer inside. Moving over to the middle of the dashboard, two large air vents up there, and then a 10.25-inch touchscreen infotainment system. The system runs Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, and the software is essentially the same as what we've seen in other Hyundai and Kia models for a while. It's worth noting that wireless smartphone integration is not supported with this system just yet. Nobody seems to be quite sure as to whether that will be available via an update, but we don't have any details yet. If you want CarPlay, you're going to have to connect that USB cable there. We have dual zone automatic climate control, basically the same controls that we find in the Tucson as well. Single USB input for that infotainment system, the USB charge only port, Qi wireless charging mat, basically the same shifter here as well. There's a button over here on the back of the shifter, and then we have a manual mode over to the left. There's a button to lock the center coupling, hill descent control, button for the 360-degree camera system, and then auto brake hold. Continuing behind that, we have the controls for the heated ventilated seats, heated steering wheel, and then a button to open this center console storage area. It's a pretty deep storage area because this is not a rear-wheel drive vehicle. So under this section right here, we simply have a drive shaft and some of the exhaust routing. As we see in the Hyundai Tucson, there's an available full LCD instrument cluster, but also like the Tucson, there's no binnacle cover over that LCD. The coverless display definitely makes the dashboard look more symmetrical, but you can get a little bit more glare in strong sunlight. The software can be tweaked, so there are 4 different themes that you can choose from. That cube theme, which I think is a little bit funny, Classic C, Classic B, and Classic A, they're configured right here in the touchscreen infotainment system. You can also link them to the drive mode if you'd rather. The steering wheel is one of Hyundai's latest 4-spoke designs. It definitely feels more modern than what we see in a decent number of trucks out there. It has sport grips up top, these interesting plastic grips right here in the middle. You'll find the voice command button. It controls for the infotainment system over here on the left side of the wheel. It controls for the available adaptive cruise control system over here on the right. Out on rougher pavement like the area that I'm on here, pickup trucks generally seem to have a bit of a firmer ride than body-on-frame SUVs that may be generally similar in size. And we see something somewhat similar in the Santa Cruz. That's because of the rear suspension design. In order to support the higher payload ratings, vehicles like the Santa Cruz need slightly firmer springs in the rear. But the ride quality in here is a little bit better than I had expected, and that's likely due to the load leveling suspension in the back. By giving this load leveling capability, they didn't have to make the springs quite as firm as they'd otherwise be. So I think the ride quality in here is actually better than the Honda Ridgeline. It's certainly better than any of the body-on-frame trucks out there that are going to be more expensive than this, like the Tacoma, the Frontier, the Ranger, etc. In fact, out on the road, this drives basically like a compact crossover that's a little bit longer and perhaps a little bit heavier. I guess you could say very much like the Hyundai Santa Fe. And because the curb weight is pretty similar to that Hyundai Santa Fe, all the performance figures are very close as well. In my preliminary testing, I was not able to test this out on my usual test surface. I was able to do that, however, very early this morning. I got 0 to 60 in 6.3 seconds. That's quite logical because the Santa Fe will do it in about 6.2. This is about 150 pounds heavier or so. 60 to 0 stopping distances are also pretty decent, but a little bit behind where we see that Santa Fe as well, again because of the added curb weight. The Santa Cruz may not be as nimble as a Hyundai Tucson, but thanks to having an incredible amount of power, passing ability is absolutely excellent. And this is certainly more fun to drive than the average mid-size crossover. The 8-speed dual-clutch transmission shifts very rapidly, but you should know that dual-clutch transmissions like this are not generally quite as capable off-road. This is probably going to overheat or just give up the ghost a little bit before the Santa Cruz with the regular 8-speed automatic transmission. So if you do plan on taking your Santa Cruz a little bit more rugged off-roading, you might actually want to get the less powerful engine, but this one is certainly going to be more fun. If you're looking for a Tucson with more practicality and a whole lot more shove, that is certainly going to be this, because this is going to be much faster than any version of the Tucson. For some reason, Hyundai has not seen fit to put this particular drivetrain in that smaller two-row crossover. Fortunately, I've been able to drive this out on roads that I know fairly well, and behind the wheel, this reminds me an awful lot of the Subaru Brat, or I guess you could say El Caminos, that classic sort of Australian ute design, because the seating position is a little bit lower than the average pickup truck, a little bit higher than the average sedan, but definitely lower than some of those mid-size or full-size trucks. Everything in here feels more car-like. It definitely feels more car-like to drive in terms of handling ability, ride quality, etc., but then it has the practicality of that truck bed in the rear. I don't have any official cabin noise figures for you just yet, but I wouldn't be surprised if this was a little bit quieter inside than the Tucson. The main reason for that would be that in the Tucson, the cargo area is part of the same space as the cabin, and in here, it is separate, and that really does add a little bit of extra sound isolation. Because this vehicle is stretched, the rear wheels are also a little bit further away from us when we're driving here in the cabin. As far as fuel economy, I also don't have any numbers for you there just yet, but Hyundai's latest turbocharged engines have proved pretty efficient, as has the 8-speed dual-clutch transmission, so I wouldn't be surprised if in daily driving this was able to meet that 22 mile per gallon figure. Bottom line, out on the road, the Santa Cruz is a surprising amount of fun. This has nearly 9 inches of ground clearance, but driving it out on these roads, it really doesn't feel like it. Now, on the other hand, I suspect that if you were to take this a little bit more rugged off-roading, or say out on some of those long trails that you'll find in national parks, that the suspension design might get a little bit tiring after a while. But that's also something that we find in the Honda Ridgeline, and to be perfectly honest, also the Nissan Frontier that I was just driving out in Utah. Any suspension that's designed for a reasonably high amount of payload in the rear is going to be fairly firm in the back. Now, in this vehicle, you could solve some of that by tossing your gear in the back, adding a few extra pounds back there, and because this has load leveling shocks, that wouldn't take away from your ground clearance. Hyundai has priced the Santa Cruz pretty aggressively, but not quite as aggressively as the Ford Maverick. This starts at $23,990 for the SE trim. You get a lot of standard equipment in that particular model, but you don't get all-wheel drive. If you want all-wheel drive, that's going to be $25,490 also for the SE trim. As you can see on the side of your screen, the SE model is pretty well equipped. I do love the fact that Apple CarPlay and Android Auto come standard, something that we don't see in a wide variety of the competition. If you want the turbo engine and all-wheel drive, which I think you probably do, that's going to step up to $35,680. That's going to get you the paddle shifters, the LED headlamps up front, the digital phone as key ability, 2-zone automatic climate control, and 5,000 pounds of towing ability. The top-end limited trim will set you back $39,720, which is definitely a lot more than the base trim, but it has everything that you saw on this model. This is a limited trim, so we have the 360-degree camera system, the blind spot monitoring system, the LCD instrument cluster, everything that you've seen in this particular model. It's important to note that with the Santa Cruz, Hyundai says they're going after a different shopper. Theoretically, this is not targeted at the same person that's shopping for a Toyota Tacoma or a Ford Ranger. And that's what makes this different than a Honda Ridgeline. Even though this obviously will get into the pricing scheme of the Honda Ridgeline, Honda is in fact trying to target that Ford Ranger customer, that Toyota Tacoma customer. And it is definitely bigger than this. It's wider, it's longer, it's not going to be quite as easy to park. This is targeted at someone that is shopping for a Ford Escape, or a Hyundai Tucson, or a RAV4, or a CR-V. But they want the ability to put bicycles back here without having them damage the interior of the vehicle. Say you want to go to the home improvement store, toss some plants back there, maybe they're wet, maybe they're leaky. Maybe you want to put your climbing gear or your gym gear and you don't want to smell up the cabin. That's exactly what this vehicle is targeted at. Someone that wants the practicality and passenger carrying ability of a crossover blended with a relatively practical small bed in the back. This is not going to be the kind of vehicle for someone that wants to tow a big heavy ski boat behind them. Obviously, you're going to have to step up into something like a Nissan Frontier or a Ford Ranger, because this towing ability tops out at about 5,000 pounds. And although that is an SAE rated towing ability, that does mean this is just below some of those larger speed boats out there. It also might be a little on the small side if you wanted to, you know, carry something like two side-by-sides somewhere. The Santa Cruz may not have been designed with high towing ability in mind, but it was certainly designed with surprisingly high payload figures, up to 1,905 pounds, depending on exactly which version of the Santa Cruz that you get. That's thanks to the general design of the vehicle, the rear suspension design, and the fact that this has a load leveling rear suspension. I have to say, I am really excited for this new generation of compact pickups in America because I love the blend. Those original really small pickup trucks in the 1970s and 1980s, they were really good for cargo carrying, but that's not the mission of this vehicle. This actually is really targeting the shopper that maybe was interested in a Subaru Brat once upon a time. The ability to carry four or five people in relative comfort on the inside, something that you could not do in those original Toyota pickup trucks, with a reasonable amount of cargo practicality in the back. Now, if you're a weekend warrior that's doing major home improvement, this is not going to suffice. You could put 4x8 sheets of things in here, but they would be hanging out the rear. Now, obviously that is more practical than not being able to do it at all, but if you're looking for the kind of truck that's going to carry half a ton of concrete and a ton of 4x8 sheet goods entirely within the cargo bed, you're going to need to look at something bigger. But this is going to be an eminently practical option for the occasional weekend warrior, I guess you could say, or someone that's simply looking for an alternative to a bigger pickup truck, something that's more fuel efficient, easier to park, easier to live with, more fun to drive, etc. But that's exactly what Ford is trying to do with the Maverick as well. How do these two new compact pickups compare with one another? Well, for that, you're going to have to wait until I can get my hands on both of them at home. So in the meantime, hit that subscribe button down there at the bottom of your screen. Find me over at Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, all those other social places, and I'll see all of you just as soon as possible. Welcome, friends. I'm glad you decided to join me today on our PBS special as we take a deep dive into the under-the-hood world of the Hyundai Santa Cruz.